Buenos días, hermanos y hermanas. Bienvenido a la casa del Señor. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I like that some of you guys are standing up. Me gusta cuando uno ya los hermanos están preparando, parándose. Por favor, si pueden su Biblia hasta Salmo 95. Open up your Bibles to Psalms 95, please. Psalms 95, Salmos 95. La palabra de Dios dice así. Venid, aclamemos alegremente a Jehová. Cantemos con júbilo a la roca de nuestra salvación. Lleguemos ante su presencia con alabanza. Aclamémosle con cánticos, porque Jehová es Dios grande y el Rey grande sobre todos los dioses. Amén.
Amén.
Amen. The word of God says, oh come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Amen?
Amen.
Let us shout joyfully to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this beautiful day. We thank you, Lord, for being our King, our Lord, our Savior. Lord, we ask you to bless us this morning, Lord. Open up our hearts to receive your word this morning. We just want to worship you, Lord, and we just want to give you thanks for everything, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. We thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. God bless you, church. Amen.
Gracias, hermanos. Dios les bendiga, hermanos y hermanas. Bendiciones. Amén. Bienvenidos a la casa del Señor. Es un placer verles aquí junto con su pueblo. Amén. Para adorarle.
Praise the Lord. We're all so happy to see you here in the house of worship this morning. So happy to see all the smiling faces. God bless each and everywhere this morning. As we worship together today, we're going to begin with, Lord, I lift your name on high.
I'm so glad you came.
manera amó Dios al mundo que ha dado a su Hijo unigénito para que todo aquel que en Él crea no se pierda, amén. No se pierda, mas tenga vida eterna.
For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son for every single one of us.
Le damos gracias, buen Dios.
We give you thanks, Heavenly Father.
Nuestra alma se regocija en medio de tu presencia.
Our soul sings and rejoices amongst your presence here with us.
Porque dice tu palabra que tú habitas en medio de la adoración de tu pueblo.
Because your word says that you dwell amongst the worship in our hearts.
Te damos las gracias por tu presencia, Señor.
We give you thanks for your presence here, Lord.
Por la vida que nos brindas, Señor.
For the life that you provide for us.
La salud de los que estamos hoy en día aquí.
And the health that we all have here in your house of worship, Lord.
Te damos muchas gracias, Señor.
We give you thanks, Lord.
Tu nombre sea glorificado.
May your name be worshipped here this morning.
En todo tiempo.
And at all times, Lord.
En el nombre de Jesús.
In the powerful name of Jesus.
Y todos decimos,
and we all say,
amen. Amen. Gloria a Dios, Cristo vive, hermanos. Amen.
Praise the Lord, Jesus lives.
Tomen asiento, mis amados.
Hello again, friends. Thank you again for inviting us into your home so that we may worship together and we may receive God's words together as well. I want to thank you for your prayerful support. I want to let you know that each and every one of you are in our thoughts and prayers as well, especially those who have not been able to join us in our in-person services. We're meeting every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock. We are also meeting in our midweek service in person every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. So I hope to see you soon. And let us know if you're still not able to join us in person, drop us a line, let us know, send us an email. We'd love to hear from you. I'm excited to introduce a brand new series today titled Fortify Your Faith. Fortify Your Faith. I think you would agree with me that if there's something that Christians need more than anything today, is we need to strengthen our faith. We need to fortify our faith. The experience that we have all gone through over the past year and a half has introduced a lot of external pressures into our lives. In fact, if you look at just one statistic, you will notice how the pandemic and how everything that followed it has created so much pressure that it's impacting homes, it's impacting marriages. In fact, one of those examples has to do with the divorce rate. There are more couples that are divorcing, more couples that are leaving each other. That statistic seems to be accelerated as a result of the pandemic. But you know what's interesting about all of that is when you start peeling the layers of the onion back, what you realize is that while it is true that we're experiencing and we're facing so much more pressure from the outside, it's not the pressure that creates the problem. It's not the pressure that causes the problem, but the pressure does reveal the problem. A lot of couples that were already having issues in their relationship, for example, the health orders that forced them to spend more time together in the same room exposed and exacerbated problems that were already there. Pressures from the outside don't cause problems, but they do reveal problems that already exist. And that's true in almost every aspect of life, including our relationship with God. Problems from the outside don't cause fractures in our relationship with God. They simply reveal fractures in our relationship with God. And when we go through fiery problems in our life, sometimes those problems strengthen us, but sometimes they shatter us. So what's the difference? What's the difference between a person whose faith is strengthened and whose relationship with God grows more deeply and profoundly when outside pressures come in, from the person whose faith dwindles and whose relationship with God actually weakens? In one word, it's faith. It's faith. Whether problems strengthen us or they shatter us, it depends on our faith. Let's be honest. The pandemic has put a lot of pressure on all of us, and some have come out of this spiritually stronger, but others have shuddered. And this is why this message in this series will teach us from the Bible how to fortify our faith, how to have the kind of faith that will sustain us and help us to come out of outside pressures and come out of difficult situations stronger in our faith, stronger in our walk, and closer to God. Today we're beginning this new series titled Fortify Your Faith, and it's about strengthening your faith in troubled times. If you want to survive the pressures of life and come out of this pressure stronger, you need to fortify your faith. Now, most people are familiar with Hebrews chapter 11. It's often referred to as the Hall of Faith. But a lot of people don't understand the background. You see, the writer of this book was writing to a group of brand new Christians. These were people that had left their old traditional ways of thinking. They had abandoned Judaism for Christianity. And these new Christians who had come out of Judaism and embraced Christianity were beginning to feel the heat for their decision. They were facing increased pressure from the Roman government, but they were also feeling the heat from their own family members for abandoning their traditional religion for this newfound Christianity. So the writer of Hebrews is telling them, don't lose your confidence. Don't lose your faith in Christ. And he says that the key to holding on to your beliefs is your faith. And that is why we're going to spend the next several weeks learning about how to fortify our faith, how to strengthen our faith. So when times get tough, so that when the heat is turned on and the pressures of life get intense, we can come out of this stronger and closer to God. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this time of worship and praise and this time that we can now spend in your word. I pray that you would use this message to encourage those who are watching, that you would use this message to encourage us, to build us up, and give us the hope that things can get better, that things will get better. And as long as we strengthen our faith and we get closer to you, nothing that happens and nothing that enters our life will distract us or weaken our faith. Thank you, Lord. I pray that you would use this series to bless the many who are watching. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Today, in the first seven verses of Hebrews chapter 11, we're going to see how the writer of Hebrews is going to do three things. First, he's going to define faith. Secondly, he's going to give us two examples of faith. And finally, he's going to explain the two requirements of faith. The principles that the writer of Hebrews offers us are the same principles and have the same relevance and impact today. Remember, he was writing to brand new believers who were feeling the heat from the Roman government, and they were feeling the pressure from their own family members for abandoning their traditional religion for Christianity. And what we see here is that the book of Hebrews tells us that the key to holding on to our beliefs in the face of difficult times is our faith. So let's begin by defining faith. Now, faith is one of those words that many people recognize. We use it all the time. Even people who are not necessarily believers or don't consider themselves religious or spiritual use the word faith all the time. The problem is that when a word gets used and overused, it begins to lose its meaning. Certainly, it's an intended meaning, especially in the context of Christianity, in the context of the Bible. So a good way to define faith is by describing what it is not. Faith always demands an object. And the only worthy object of true, genuine faith is God. Faith is not positive thinking. There are people who believe that by telling themselves and by saying to themselves, I believe it'll happen, I believe it'll happen, I believe it'll happen, they believe that they can will it into existence, that you can believe something into existence. But that's not faith, that's presumption. The Bible tells us that faith is more than just hoping that something will happen, wishing that something will happen, or thinking something into existence. It's not positive thinking. Instead, the Bible gives us this definition of faith. First, it offers us a definition in words. And this brings us to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Listen to these words, Hebrews 11, 1. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. And I want you to notice the two fundamental words in this verse. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. The word assurance is actually made up of two Greek words that were merged together, upostasis. And the two Greek words in upostasis, stasis literally means a concrete pillar that holds something up. And underneath, upper literally means something underneath or below. It refers to the foundation that holds those pillars into faith. It's not some mystical hope that something will happen. It's the concrete assurance that something is going to happen. And you see, that's the difference. Faith, according to Scripture, is an assurance. It's a conviction. There's no doubt. There's no room for uncertainty. It's a conviction. It's an assurance. Now, faith is the assurance that God will do what He has promised to do. It's not that God will do what I want Him to do, but what He wants to do. You see, God never promised to spare you from illness, from heartache, or from death. But what He has promised to you is to redeem you so that you can spend eternity in heaven with Him. So that's assurance. Now notice the second word. It's not just an assurance. Faith is the assurance, but it's also the conviction. And then conviction is the idea of doing something as a result of your faith. It refers to obeying God. And as we examine Hebrews chapter 11 over the coming weeks, we will observe people of faith who acted on their faith. And that's what distinguished them. The true test and the true evidence of someone who lived by faith is someone who walked by faith. It's someone who acted on their belief, and that action was driven by their conviction. And that conviction was based on the assurance. So here's a definition of faith. Understanding what these two words mean and how the two words come together, here's a definition of faith. Faith then is the assurance that God will do what He has promised to do and act accordingly. That's faith. That's faith. Hebrews 11 verse 2 says, "For by it, faith, the men of old gained approval." Now, after the writer of Hebrews defines faith in words, he then illustrates what faith looks like in the lives of two individuals. In verse number 3, he says, "By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible." For example, there are things that you and I cannot see, but we know they exist. In fact, we believe they exist. One example is electricity. Unless something goes wrong, you can't see electricity, but you can tell when the power is on because the lights are lit and your radio and all your electronic machines and gadgets are operating. Your clock is functioning well. Electricity is invisible. You don't see the current that's moving through those power lines, but you know it exists. And you see the evidence of it, and the evidence surrounds us. Another example is something that we know exists, we believe exists, but can't see is love. We know love is real, we know love exists, and we know that there is love between people, there's love between people and God. But love is not something that is visible, it's manifested, it's expressed, and it's perceived, it's seen. And it's important for us then to understand that faith is the same way. It's really hard to see it, but it's really easy to see it illustrated. And that's what the writer of Hebrews tries to do in Hebrews 11, verse 3. And he gives us two examples of faith in the lives of two individuals. And we see that in verse number 4. Hebrews 11, 4 says, "By faith, Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained the testimony that he was righteous, God testifying about his gifts, and through faith, though he is dead, he still speaks." Now, we all know Abel and Cain. Cain and Abel were the first two children of Adam and Eve. And we see here that Abel brought a better sacrifice. A better sacrifice. Now, I've heard people talk about this passage in Genesis and comment on it, and I've heard Bible studies, I've read commentaries on this, and one of the things I've heard in the past is how people talk about the attitude with which they presented this to God, their hearts, right? That Abel's attitude and Abel's heart was more aligned with God, and that's the reason why God, you know, accepted his sacrifice but not Cain's. But when you read the text and you let the words explain and describe, it says, "By faith, Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain." A better sacrifice. Now, why was his better? I'll tell you why. Abel's sacrifice was better than Cain's because Abel gave God what Abel asked for. In other words, it was his obedience. Cain, on the other hand, thought about it and said, "God, do you really want that? Are you sure you want that? I think, God, what you really need, and maybe what you really meant, and God, really, what you really want is this instead." But you begin to see the connection, the relationship between faith and obedience. It was Abel's faith, the assurance, and the conviction that drove him to obey God's command. God asked both clearly for something, what the sacrifice should look like, but Cain decided to bring something different. And in fact, Jude 11 tells us to avoid the way of Cain. In other words, coming to God on your own terms. Coming to God on your own terms is not obeying God, and it reflects lack of faith in God, because when you have faith in God, your faith will drive you to obey God. And that is precisely what Cain did not do, but that is exactly what Abel did. And it was by faith that Abel offered a better sacrifice. Now, some people ask, how were the saints of the Old Testament saved? How did people in the Old Testament before Jesus came and died on the cross and rose from the grave, how were they saved? How were the people that were close to God, and what was the determining factor? Now, since the beginning of time, we have all been saved the same way. Our forgiveness is based on three things. First, it's based on God's grace. It's based on God's grace. God doesn't have to save us. He wants to save us. It's based on his grace. We don't deserve it. We're not worthy, but it's God's grace. Our forgiveness is based on God's grace. Secondly, it's paid for by Christ's blood. The price that was paid was the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. Thirdly, it's received through our faith. Our forgiveness is based on God's grace. It's paid for by Christ's blood. And it's received through our faith. And that's what we read in Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast." You see, friends, all of us are saved by God's grace, never by works. Never by works. Let's say, to give you an example, you're walking downtown, all of a sudden you hear sirens and you see fire trucks and they're all making their way to a building up ahead, and you notice that one of the floors has smoke coming out of it. And you notice from a distance that there's a man who's looking out through one of the broken windows. And he's looking down and he notices that the fire department has laid out a net for this man to jump. And this man is deciding, should I jump or should I not? Should I stay in this burning building and let the smoke inhalation get me down, or should I jump into the net? And next thing you know, you see this man jump and he falls onto the net to safety. Now, was he saved because he jumped? Jumping wasn't what saved him, right? The firefighters offered him the provision of that net. He was saved by the net that he accessed through jumping. In other words, the net that was offered him is what allowed him to jump, but when he decided to take the plunge, when he decided to put his trust in that net that was below him, that decision is what saved him. And that's what Abel did. Abel believed what God said. He was saved by God's grace, which he received by God's grace. And so you see, faith is not only essential to our salvation. Faith is also essential for our sanctification. And that brings us to the next example. Hebrews 11:5 introduces us to the faith of Enoch. It says, by faith Enoch was taken up so that he would not see death, and he was not found because God took him up. For he obtained the witness of that before his being taken up, he was pleasing to God. Now, Genesis tells us a little more about Enoch. In Genesis 5:21 through 24, it says that Enoch lived 65 years and became the father of Methuselah. Methuselah, as you know, was the man recorded in the Bible who lived the longest. Then Enoch walked with God 300 years after he became the father of Methuselah, and he had other sons and daughters. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. What's interesting about this passage is that Enoch lived 365 years, but he didn't start walking with God until he was 65. In other words, one could say that Enoch wasted the first 65 years of his life. And this reminds us all that it's not how you start your life, but how you finish. You see, God doesn't care about your past. He cares about your future. He cares about today and the next day and where your heart will go in relationship to Him. Every other person in Genesis, if you read the entire book, will say, and he died. Not Enoch. God took him. When the Bible says that he was not, it literally means that God raptured him. He took him. He didn't experience death. Now, why would God spare Enoch of death? Because he walked with God. Now, to walk with God doesn't mean that you take an afternoon stroll with him every day. To walk with God means to please God. Enoch's heart was aligned with God's. His life, how he lived, how he thought, it was in alignment with God. It pleased God. And he wanted to please God with all of his life. What was his desire to please God? It was his faith. You see the relationship between faith and pleasing God in verses 6 and 7. And this brings us to the requirement of faith. Hebrews 11, 6 and 7. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. What these verses tell us is that without faith, you cannot please God, because without faith, you cannot obey God. And only those who believe are obedient, and only those who are obedient truly believe. That's why the Bible says without faith, you cannot please God. You cannot continually please him. You will never please God unless you believe he exists. And here's one more example, Hebrews 11, 7. The requirement of faith. You must believe that he exists, but you must also believe that God rewards. Look at Hebrews 11, 7. By faith, Noah, being warned by God about things not yet seen, in reverence prepared an ark for the salvation of his household, by which he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. Now remember, when the Lord called Noah and assigned him this daunting mission to build this gigantic ark, at a time when rain was not known to man, Noah built a way. It had never rained, yet Noah believed. Noah believed a God he could not see, and he believed in that God so much that he obeyed his command. And he dedicated the rest of his life to obeying God. And he became an heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. And this is what Hebrews 11:7 points out. It says that he became Noah because of his faith, being warned by God about things not yet seen, in other words, the rain, in reverence prepared an ark for the salvation of his household by which he condemned the world, and became an heir of righteousness which is according to faith. According to faith. All the Bible characters that we will read about in Hebrews 11 obeyed God. What is it that gave them that ability to keep believing God even when they knew the rewards would not come immediately? Faith, the essential ingredient. You see, right now we're living in times where we're facing so much pressure from the outside. It could be economic. It could be medical related. It could be job related. It could be political. There's a lot of pressure that's squeezing people in. And the question is, what problems is that pressure revealing? And what is that pressure doing to your faith? Friends, that's why we're learning about how to fortify our faith, how to strengthen our faith. If there's one thing we need today in these difficult times, is to have our faith strengthened. Let's pray. We thank you, God, for this time that we can spend in your word. Thank you for showing us that faith is the essential ingredient, not just for salvation, but also for sanctification. Teach us, Lord, remind us, encourage us to strengthen, to fortify our faith, because it is our faith that will enable us to believe you, to obey you, to walk with you. Help us, Lord, to see our faith strengthened so that we can get closer to you and do more for you. And I pray for those who are watching, whose faith has been affected by all that we have experienced over the last year and a half, that you would strengthen their faith, that they would have a desire to see their faith fortified. And I pray for all of their needs. You know them all. In Jesus' name, amen. Remember, friends, the most essential ingredient is your faith in Jesus Christ. God bless you all.